Puss in Boots. Once upon a time, there was a miller who had three sons. He wasn't a very rich miller. He had a mill and some farm buildings, a donkey and a cat. When the old miller died, he left his property divided between his three sons. The eldest son inherited the mill and the farm buildings. The second son was left the donkey. The youngest was given the cat. The first two sons were quite happy with their lot. "I'll be able to make a good living with this mill," said the eldest son. "I can grind the corn, store it in the farm buildings, and sell it at the market." "With this trusty old donkey," exclaimed the second son, "I can help my brother take his corn to market and help the other millers too." The youngest son listened to his brothers and then looked at the cat his father had left him. He was none too pleased. "Ha!" he grunted. "My brothers will be able to earn their fortune, while all I have is this miserable cat. I suppose I could always eat it if I was starving to death." At this, the cat sat up and looked at him in a very strange way.
"Master," he purred, "your brothers may have inherited the more obvious routes to wealth, but I can assure you I'm no ordinary cat."
The youngest son stared in surprise. A cat that spoke was definitely not an ordinary cat. He listened very carefully.
"All I require," continued the cat, "is a hat with a plume, a bag, and a cape. But most importantly, a very special pair of boots. They must be long and brown with large gold buckles. With these things, I can make your fortune."
The youngest son almost laughed out loud, but then he remembered that the cat had indeed always seemed very clever. He'd used all sorts of strange tricks to catch the mice and rats around the mill, and his father had always held the cat in high regard.
"Well," replied the son, "I've only a few shillings left, so I may as well gamble them on you."
He bought the cat a fine plumed cap, a bag, a red cape, and a magnificent pair of brown boots. The cat looked the picture of elegance as he dressed in his new outfit.
"Brrr, thank you, master," he said. "I promise you will not be disappointed. But," he added, "you must do whatever I say the next time we meet."
And so, the youngest son did not see the cat for several weeks. In fact, he began to wonder if the cat had run away with his fine cape and boots. But all this time, the cat was very busy. Every day he would go hunting for rabbits and game, and because he was such a clever cat, by the end of the day his bag was bulging with plump young rabbits and tender birds. And every day the cat would go to the palace of the king and ask to see his majesty. When he was shown into the royal chamber, the cat would bow low and sweep off his plumed hat. As he produced a rabbit or bird from his bag, he would say,
"Sire, may I offer you this humble gift from my master, the Marquis of Carabas, which he has asked me to present to you on his behalf?"
"Pray inform your master,"
replied the king, who was most impressed,
"that I thank him and accept the gift with great pleasure."
For several weeks, the cat paid a daily visit to the king. The king began to be very curious about his loyal subject, the Marquis of Carabas. Meanwhile, the youngest son waited to hear from the clever cat who would make his fortune. Finally, the cat reappeared at the mill.
"Good morning, master,"
he purred.
"Do you remember that I told you the next time we met, I would ask you to do something?"
"Yes,"
replied the youngest son.
I remember it well.
Then listen carefully, said the cat. Tomorrow morning you must go swimming in the lake by the road from the palace. All you have to do is swim. Leave the rest to me.
The youngest son did not argue, and the following morning he did what the cat had ordered. Leaving his clothes in a neat pile on the side of the lake, he dived in and began to swim up and down. At that moment, the king drove by in a carriage with his beautiful daughter. Suddenly, the cat appeared at the side of the road.
Help! Help!
He cried.
My lord, the Marquis of Carabas, is drowning!
Hearing this cry, the king leant out of the carriage and recognized the cat who had brought him the gifts. He ordered his footman to rescue the Marquis from the lake. While they were pulling the Marquis from the lake, the cat explained to the king how some thieves had run off with his master's clothes. The king commanded his footman to fetch the Marquis some of his finest clothes. And when he was clothed in this splendid attire, he looked very handsome. The king begged him to join them in his carriage, and as soon as the youngest son set eyes on the beautiful princess, he fell hopelessly in love. As the carriage progressed through the countryside, the king chattered happily to the courteous Marquis, while all the time the clever cat was up to his tricks. The cat knew that all the countryside they were passing through belonged to a vicious ogre that everyone hated. So, he ran along in front of the coach, and to every farm labourer he met, he gave the same message.
If you want to be free of the ogre, all you have to do is tell the next person who asks you that all this land belongs to the Marquis of Carabas.
The people were amazed at his message, but they were also amazed to hear a cat talk. Meanwhile, the king continued to talk to the Marquis, and his daughter gently asked him questions too. As they rounded a bend in the road, they came across a group of farm labourers. The king leant out of the carriage and addressed the men.
Who does all this land you tend belong to?
The men replied in unison,
It belongs to our master, the Marquis of Carabas.
The king was very impressed, and he congratulated the Marquis on his choice of land.
You have a splendid domain here,
he commented, and his daughter agreed. It was becoming very obvious that she found the Marquis very much to her liking. The younger son nodded and smiled at the king and his daughter, while he wondered what on earth that clever cat was up to. The cat was still walking in front of the carriage, and this time he came to a group of men and women harvesting the tall golden corn. He repeated his promise to them.
If you tell the next person who asks you that this land and this corn belongs to the Marquis of Carabas, I promise to free you from the ogre's cruel rule.
A few minutes later, the royal coach appeared. The king was looking out of the window, and he could not help but notice the huge fields of golden corn with the men and women busy cutting it down. He called to the coachman to stop, and he leant out of the window and addressed the nearest harvester.
Good day, my man, he said. Pray tell me, who owns all this fair land?
The man put down his scythe and replied,
Why, sire, it belongs to our good and noble lord, the Marquis of Carabas.
The king was even more impressed.
Well,
he chuckled.
You certainly have some fine corn and the respect of those who work your land.
The younger son kept smiling and nodding, while he wondered just what the cat would get up to next. The clever cat was very glad that his plan seemed to be working so well. He watched the coach bowling along with the king and the princess, smiling and laughing with his master. Brrr! Now for the next part of my plan, he purred, as he took a short cut through the fields to the ogre's castle. It was a very grand castle, and the ogre was a very fierce and terrible ogre. He frightened all the people with his loud voice and cruel ways. He was very rich because he scared the people so much that they gave him all their valuable things so he would leave them alone. His castle was full of gold and silver and precious jewels. The ogre had no friends and very few visitors, and so he was surprised when his servant announced that a cat in boots with a red cape and a hat with a plume wanted to pay his respects to the ogre.
Show him in,
roared the ogre.
This should be fun. I haven't been cruel and mean and nasty to anyone for at least a day. A puss in boots. Let's see if I can make him shake in his boots then.
A servant showed the cat into the room.
So,
roared the ogre,
you're the puss in boots then.
And although the ogre looked and sounded fierce, he was a little taken aback. After all, it's not every day that you see a cat with fine brown boots trimmed with a golden buckle, a red cape, and a hat with a plume.
At your service, sire,
replied the cat as he bowed low before the ogre. The ogre was not amused. It was bad enough that the cat wore boots, but it was unheard of that he was not afraid of him. The ogre fixed the cat with his fiercest expression.
I don't need your services, he growled. But I will take your boots, and your cape, and your plumed hat. Then I will have something to remember you by after I have eaten you for my supper.
And he leant back in his chair and laughed a really horrible laugh. The cat was not at all afraid as he continued,
I have travelled a long way, sire, to pay you my respects, for I have heard that you can perform amazing feats. I have even heard it said that you can turn yourself into anything you want.
The ogre was easily flattered.
Well, he said, what you have heard is true. I can turn myself into anything I wish.
Can you turn yourself into an animal?
Asked the cat in awe.
Oh, yes,
boasted the ogre.
I could be a horse, or a cow, or a dog, or a...
Then he remembered how fierce he was supposed to be.
Or a lion.
I don't believe you, taunted the cat.
And with a roar, the ogre turned himself into a huge lion with a long mane, golden glistening eyes, and long, sharp teeth. He chased poor Puss around the room, snapping at his tail, until the cat had to clamber up into the rafters of the roof for safety, which is not an easy thing to do when you're wearing large brown boots. From his spot in the roof, The cat watched and waited until, with a final roar, the lion changed back into the ogre.
"Well,"
called the ogre,
"what did you think of that?"
The cat climbed down and said, "That was very impressive. But I bet you can't turn yourself into a tiny animal."
"We'll see about that,"
roared the ogre, getting very annoyed.
"What sort of tiny animal had you in mind?"
"What about a mouse?" suggested the clever cat very quietly.
"Ah, that's easy,"
sneered the ogre, and he changed into a tiny mouse. In a flash, the cat pounced upon him and gobbled him up. And that was the end of the ogre. Quickly, the cat gathered together the ogre's servants and told them to prepare a great feast for their new master, the Marquis of Carabas. Then he dashed across the drawbridge and was just in time to see the king's carriage approaching. The carriage slowed down as it neared the castle, and the cat stepped out into the road.
"Good evening, sire,"
he called out.
"Welcome to the home of my master, the Marquis of Carabas."
The king looked at the younger son in surprise.
"My lord Marquis," he exclaimed, "there seems no end to the property you own, but this castle is truly beautiful."
The princess murmured her approval too. Proudly, the younger son led them into the castle and into the great hall, where a marvelous banquet was laid out. The king was very impressed as he looked around at the magnificent interior and marveled at the gold and silver on the table. The princess was busy looking too, but only at the younger son, who held her hand gently as he led her to the table. By the time the meal was ended, the king had agreed to give the hand of his beautiful daughter to the Marquis of Carabas. Shortly afterwards, the Marquis and the princess were married. The clever cat was the guest of honor, and he lived the rest of his days in the castle, entertaining royal guests, chasing mice when he felt like it, and generally behaving like a lord. In fact, the Marquis made him a lord as a thank you for making his fortune.